पाही माँ श्री गुरु पाही माँ परम दयालु पाही माँ श्री जगद्गुरु पाही माँ भारती तीर्थ पाही माँ श्री गुरु पाही मां परम दयालु पाही मां श्रृंगी जगद्गुरु पाही मां भारती तीर्थ पाही मां श्री गुरु पाही मां परम दयालु पाही मां श्रृंगी जगद्गुरु पाही मां भारती तीर्थ पाही मां श्री गुरु परम दयालु पाही मां श्रृंगी जगद्गुरु पाही मां भारती तीर्थ पाही मां
It's about 5 minutes to start. Jambuji, Dr. Jambunathan, you want to start the introduction, please? Go ahead.
Okay. So, namaskaram. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Okay. You can switch on your video as well.
Namaskarams to all devotees and happy Shankara Jayanti. And you know, we are very privileged and honored today on this auspicious day to have our SVBF chairman and Dharmatma Shri Subramaniam deliver his inaugural Vedanta lecture. As most of you know, Sri Subramaniam doesn't need any introduction, and he has been a pillar of Sanatana Dharma both in United States as well as in India, He has organized so much Veda Sammelans, and he has lived a life of a Vedic scholar, though he has been like a professional like us. And I remember him telling very clearly once that he is a PhD in material science, but he has spent his life on spiritual sciences, which is exactly the truth. His PhD may be in material science, but he has been a pillar of spirituality and propagating the spiritual message. And I remember very clearly, like several years ago in the SVB of Stroudsburg, Kumbhabhishekam, he is the one who first organized the Adirudram and Sahasra Chandi and converted the entire Stroudsburg area to a major Agraharam, which is an achievement, you know, which is unparalleled so far in the United States. And we know his all these scholarly contributions. He does his Upanishad lectures, Brahma Sutra lectures, and all Adi Shankara work lectures, which he's been doing regularly for several years for his disciples. And so he's a person who has been accomplished both on the Vedic ritual parts as well as the Vedic scholarship part. So I would like to call him, which I have told him personally, that as the Appaya Diksha of the 20th century, who has a parallel in both, you know, Vedic rituals and Vedic scholarship. And it is our privilege for our 20th century Appaya Dikshadhar, Dharmatma Shri Agna Subramaniam, who has been also given the title Dharmatma, which is a very, very rare and unique title. It is something equivalent to Bharat Ratna in the spiritual circles, which has been confirmed by His Holiness Jagadguru himself. And so a person of such accomplishments and such spiritual towering personality, it is very auspicious for us to have the inaugural lecture on this Shankara Jayanti. And I would like to request him now to give us his words of wisdom and also guidance during his lecture. Namaskaram, Mama. Thank you for joining us.
ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः नमस्ते शारदे देवी शृङ्गेरिपुरवासिनीम् स्वामहं प्रार्थये नित्यं विद्यां बुद्धिं च देहि मे श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करं विवेकिनं महाप्रज्ञं धैर्योद्धार्यक्षमानिधिं सदाभिनवपूर्वं तं विद्यातीर्थगुरुं भजे भारतीकरुणापात्रं भारतीपदभूषणं भारती पदमारूढं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारतीं सद्गुरु चरणारविंदाभ्यां नमः। डियर ब्रह्म बंधुस, आई सबमिट मई अनंत कोटि साष्टांग नमस्कारम सेट द लोटस फीट of our Ubhaya Jagadgurus, their holinesses, Sri Sri Bharati Tirtha Mahasannidhanam and Sri Sri Vidushekara Bharati Sannidhanam on this very special occasion when SVBF North is starting their Vande Vidya Shankaram, a series of lectures on Sanatana Dharma on the day of Shankara Jayanti. Dr. Jambunathan kindly requested me to give the inaugural lecture on Vedanta and Sri Vidya. But today I chose to talk about Vedanta as the topic and give a general outline. Yeah, this is an inaugural lecture. There are so many nice topics are planned. I saw the announcements. Sanatana Dharma, as you know, has many unique features. And the most noteworthy among those are the concepts of punya, papa, rebirth, srishti, moksha, so many of them. And punyam and papam are the results of one's own actions through manasa, due to the mental actions, thoughts, manasa, then vacha, verbal actions, words and speech, and karmana, physical actions. And the results are the palam of the actions can be punyam, if they are as per dharmic codes, vidhi, or papam if they are otherwise. They are nisheda. So that is why Lord Krishna said, Uddharedatmanatmanam natmanam avasadhayet atmaiva hyatmana banduho atmaiva ripuratmanaha. Elevate oneself through the power of your mind and not degrade yourself, because the mind can be the friend and also the enemy. And the phalam, the results of the action, are both adrishtam, unseen, invisible, or drishtam, visible. And punyam and papam are in that category. For example, when one sees a beggar in front of a temple or elsewhere, which is a common sight in India, if one gives him food or money, the visible phalam is removing his anger. And the invisible result is the punyam arising from such a noble act, which leads to the type of janma one might get in a future life. As long as a balance of karma, karma phalam exists, punarjanma or rebirth cannot be avoided. That is why Lord Krishna said, Abrahma bhuvanan lokaha punaravarti norjuna mamupi etyatu kaunteya punarjanmana vidyate. Due to enormous punya, even if a person reaches the Brahma loka, Satya loka, one will be subject to still rebirth, O Arjuna. But on attaining my abode, there is no further rebirth. That is why during Shravani Purnami, we make the sankalpa, anadi avidya vasanaya pravartamane asmin mahati samsara chakre vichitrabihi karmabihi vichitrasu yonishu puna punaha anekada janitva kenapi punya karma visheshena idanintana manushye dvijanma vishesham praptavataha anadi avidya vasanaya. Due to the ignorance from beginningless times, anadi pravartamane asmin mahati samsara chakre, continuing this present big samsara cycle up to now, vichitrabihi karmagatibihi vichitrasu yonishu punapunaha anekada janitva, born due to various karmas in various places, and kenapi punya karma visheshena, due to some punya karma, karma visesha, idanim tana manushye dvijanma visesham praptavataha, this dvija, manushya janma, has been attained. And later, the sankalpa prays for the relief from all kinds of papams done through manasa, vacha, karmana, karmendriyas, jnanendriyas, mahapadakas, upapadakas, all that big list is given. As long as the karma balance continues, punarjanma cannot be avoided. And moksha is freedom from punarjanma, liberation it is called. That is why Acharya Shankaracharya in Viveka Chudamani, he wrote a very nice verse. Durlabham trayame vaitate devanugraha ketu hetukam manushyatvam mumukshutvam mahapurusha samshrayaha. There are three things which are rare indeed, durlabham, and they are due to the grace of Lord only. Manushyatvam, to be born as a human being. Mumukshutvam, the craving, longing, desire for moksha, and association of mahapurushas, mahapurusha samshraya. Then why is this human birth rare and superior? In Hitopadesha, there is a popular shloka which reads as, Ahara nidra bhayamai tunani samanyamedat pashubhir naranam buddhir hitesham adhiko visheshaham buddhyavihinaha pashubhissamanaha. This shloka talks about the superiority of human beings. If we see, many things are common between animals and humans. Humans are basically an animal only. They call him social animal. Ahara, sleep, insecurity, procreation. They are samanya metat pashubhir naranam, common to both animals and humans. Then why is human's life superior? It is because buddhirhi tesham adhiko visheshaha, intellect, or the power of reasoning, is the extra faculty because of which the human life is different. Therefore, buddhya vihinaha, without the thinking faculty, a human being is no different from an animal. He is able to reason out and can have clear-cut goals in one's life. And because it is rare to get a human birth, one should understand what is one's ultimate goal in life, which according to Vedanta is to gain moksha or liberation. And what is this liberation? It is the relief from the cycle of innumerable births and deaths, according to one's karma, karma phala, leading to punyam, papam, all that. And according to our scriptures, moksha or liberation is possible only through gaining the knowledge of oneself, one's own true nature. And so the next important rare thing is mumukshutvam, manushyatvam, mumukshutvam, the craving desire to gain moksha. What is this craving? Tivra Icha, it is called. What is this Tivra Icha? Swami Ramakrishna, there is a story about him. Once a disciple went to him and he wanted to know from him whether he can see God. And he told, you are a God person. Will you be able to show God to me? Ramakrishna said, yes, no problem. Come to me early morning tomorrow. Let us go to the Ganges. Let us have a holy dip and I'll show you God. He took him there early morning promptly. They went into the Ganges River. He took him inside, knee deep, waist deep, neck deep, and still going. And at one point, Ramakrishna held his head and pushed him under water and kept him pressed for 2 seconds, 5 seconds, few seconds, few more seconds, 10 seconds. This person who is submerged in water just came out with such a force. Then Ramakrishna asked him, how was the experience? The disciple said, I thought you are showing me God, but you seem to be already packing me to God. With what force and that conviction you pushed yourself out of that water, do you have that conviction to see God? If you have such a desire, tivra icha, you will be able to see him. So that is a desire to gain moksha. And as Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, manushya anam sahasreshu kaschidyatati siddhaye yatata amapi siddhanam kaschin mam veti tatvataha. Among thousands of people, hardly one strives for perfection. And among those also, hardly one knows the ultimate truth. And the accomplishment of this goal is possible only through a guru, a mahapurusha, who has to guide the student to first become an adhikari, the eligible, and then provide the tools, namely the understanding of the scriptures, to pursue the path of knowledge, jnana marga. That is why mahapurusha sanshraya is also durlabham to gain. And that opportunity to have the association of such a caring mahapurusha is rare, durlabham. In such an understanding, 6 topics are very important, which are connected with human thinking, human intellect. First thing is one should know about oneself, the jiva. One should know about the universe, the jagat. One should know about Ishvara, the Lord. And the bondage or samsara, which is the cause of all sufferings, they're called bandha. And moksha or mukti or freedom from this bondage, that is moksha. And having known all these, the means by which one gets liberation, the moksha, they are the sadhanas. One should know all these 6. Okay. Since self-knowledge or knowledge of the nature of oneself alone is moksha, now let us spend some time to understand some basic concepts. In life, every being which has taken birth searches for happiness, called the sukha prapti, getting education, getting a good job, acquiring wealth, name, fame, all of them. They are all, for example, some examples of very limitless desires of all in general. Sky is the limit for desires. As one desires to obtain what one wants, one also desires not to get what one does not want. Not getting what is wanted and are getting what is not wanted, they both result in sorrow. And therefore, one likes to get rid of the resulting sorrow. This is called dukkha nivritti. Sukha prapti and dukkha nivritti. Thus, the happiness that a person seeks should be what? It should be an unalloyed happiness. I can use the word alloy because I'm a material scientist. It's an unalloyed happiness. It should be dukkham free sukham. And it should be eternal happiness, nitya sukham. I want the sukham to be always. And not in limited quantities. I want infinite or limitless happiness. Niratika, niratishaya sukham. So dukkham free sukham, nitya sukham, niratishaya sukham, all these every being wants. And when one wonders as to how to acquire such a happiness, then a question will arise. Is it at all possible to acquire such a happiness? There was a British mathematician philosopher called Bertrand Russell who wrote a book, Is Happiness Still Possible? Is happiness still possible? The conquest of happiness. He's a mathematician. And when we analyze the nature of beings, we generally observe two types of properties. The properties or the characteristics are explained by a popular example of the process of heating water. Take a water and heat it. Water is kept on a vessel, heated with a flame, and the nature or dharma of water is cold. And the nature of flame is heat. So during the process of heating, the vessel acquires the heat of the flame first, and then the water in the vessel. Or the heat of the hot water is acquired from the flame. Hot water loses its heat once the flame is removed. So the coldness of water and heat of the flame are natural to them, respectively. And they are called intrinsic properties. Some of them may be elementary, but I have to still say because the topic. So it is called in Sanskrit, Swarupa Lakshana, intrinsic properties. So intrinsic property does not depend on any external condition and it is eternal. So the heat of the water is borrowed from the flame and is lost by change of the external conditions, namely removal of the flame. Thus the heatness of the water is an acquired or borrowed property and it is not eternal and it is ephemeral. Given the above analysis, the term acquisition of nitya sukham itself is a misnomer because it cannot depend on any external conditions at all. Because the moment you remove the condition, the happiness goes away. So what is acquired in time will also go away in time. So this leads to the answer to the tempting question, why one should pursue the learning of Vedanta? Vedanta teaches the true nature of oneself. It is divine, it is unalloyed, it is infinite, and it is eternal happiness. That means the true happiness is not something that needs to be acquired, but it is intrinsic to all beings and it has to be only wound up. The term Vedanta literally means that which is kept physically at the end of the Vedas, Vedasya Antaha. Logically also, it is the ultimate knowledge, that's the end that one should seek. There is nothing else to be sought after this is known. Now, when we talk about knowledge, this is not a secular knowledge like that of chemistry knowledge, physics knowledge, mathematics knowledge, and all that. They are called Paurusheya Jnanam of human origin. But the knowledge of rebirth, knowledge of moksha, punya, papa, they are not of human origin. Even the caste may be human. They are called Apaurusheya Vishayas. They are revealed through our scriptures only. which are themselves apaurushaya. Vedas are apaurushaya, not of a human origin. Vedavyasa only codified them. He is not the writer of Vedas. They are revealed through our Vedic scriptures, which are themselves apaurushaya. That means to gain moksha or liberation from the cycle of birth and death, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, that cycle, one has to necessarily seek the guidance of the basic scriptures as revealed by a competent guru. Now let us spend some time to understand our Vedic scriptures themselves. For us, the word religion means dharma. That which, when followed, will give contentment and happiness, fullness. To know our dharma and dharmic principles, one has to refer to certain specific texts or granthas. They are called dharma pramanas. Pramana means that which establishes the truth. Dharma pramanas are those texts which give the true knowledge of dharma. And they normally enumerate 14 of them. Angani Vedas Chatvaro Mimamso Nyaya Vistaraha Puranam Dharma Shastrancha Vidyahetas Chaturdasha. The four Vedas, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharva Veda, the six Vedangas, they are called the organs of the Vedas, Siksha Shastram dealing with the Varnas, letters, pronunciation, euphony, and Vyakarana, grammar, Sanskrit grammar, Vedic grammar, Chandas, the Vedic meter, Nirukta, the etymology of words, Jyotisha, astronomy and astrology, Kalpa, the procedures. And there are four Upanga, subsidiary organs, called Mimamsa, interpretation of Vedic texts, Nyaya, logic, Puranas, mythology, and Dharma Shastras, which contain the codes of conduct. Since they contain the ultimate knowledge, these 14 are called Vidyasthanas. And there are four Upavedas also, Ayurveda, science of life, Arthashastra, science of wealth and economics, Dhanurveda, archery, science of relating to weaponry and warfare, Gandharva Veda, treatise on fine arts like music, dance, and all that thing. So even though we have enumerated a broad outline of our scriptures, there are particularly three authoritarian texts of Tattva Jnana called Prasthana Trayi, namely Srimad Bhagavad Gita, the Upanishads, and Brahma Sutras. Vedas are called the Shruti, that is heard. It is not written by anyone. They mostly contain cryptic statements. Satyam Vada, Dharmam Chara. The Puranas, the Itihasas, they are called Smriti Granthas of human origin, but communicating what is already revealed in the Shruti only, the Vedas only, so that even common people can understand them through stories. If Veda says Satyam Vada, there is a story of Harishchandra, so that common people can relate to it and understand that. Therefore, among the Prasthana Trayi, Bhagavad Gita is called Smriti Prasthana. It is not Veda, it is Smriti Prasthana. Upanishads are called Shruti Prasthana because they are part of Vedas. And Brahma Sutras are called Nyaya Prasthana since it deals with the logical exposition of the Upanishads written by Vedavyasa. So even though these three texts capture the ultimate truth as expounded in the Vedic scriptures, to understand them, one needs a guru. And several acharyas have written commentaries on Vedas, the Bhagavad Gita, the Upanishads, the Brahma Sutras, and all of them. There are commentaries, sub-commentaries, and sub-sub-commentaries, so many of them are there. Adi Shankaracharya has written commentaries on all these three. Now, the Vedic scriptures, it has two, broadly can be have classified to have two sections. One is called the Karma Kanda portion, and another is called the Jnana Kanda portion. And the Karma Kanda portion contains the Samhitas, Brahmanas, Aranyaka. Samhita is derived from the root. Sam means correct, proper, and Hita means arranged, put together, collected. So a structured combination of hymns, verses, called Samhita. Mantras like the various suktas, Purusha Suktam, Sri Suktam, Sri Rudram, Chamakam, they are all the Samhita portion of the Vedas. Then Brahmanas are mostly in prose form and refer to many rituals and connected explanations. For example, there's a famous Brahmana called Shatapatha Brahmanam, Taittiriya Brahmanam. So many Brahmanas are there. There's not any caste. Brahmanas are caste in prose form. And Aranyakas, they are generally called forest texts revealed by those rishis who expounded the concepts of samhitas. For example, Taittiriya Aranyaka, the first chapter, the Aruna Prashnam, the Surya Namaskara Mantra, is in Taittiriya Aranyaka, first chapter. So all belong to Vedic literature. And the Upanishads are kept at the end of the Aranyakas. And Jnanakanda sections deal with Vedanta and it contains Upanishads, Brahma Sutras and those kinds of texts. But Bhagavad Gita itself is called an Upanishad only. It's called the Gita Upanishad because of its content. However, the terms used in these Vedantic sections are not defined, but only cryptic statements in the Vedas. For example, Upanishad statements like Prajnanam Brahma, consciousness is Brahman, Tat Tvam Asi, that you are, Aham Brahma Asmi, I am Brahman, I am Atma Brahma, this self within me is Brahman. So when one says Aham Brahma Asmi, it means I am Brahman, the eternal. It is not acquiring Brahmanhood in future. It is present. I am Brahman. I am eternal. It is not an event in future. Words used in such statements like Atma, Brahman, all that thing, they have got packed in them in mysterious depths. Endless suggestions and imports that an ordinary student who is not qualified, who may not have the necessary tools, may not be able to grasp properly and needs special orientation. And that is why Shankaracharya, in addition to writing various commentaries on Bhagavad Gita, the Upanishads and Brahma Sutras, he wrote several other texts, elucidative texts called the Prakarana Granthas, such as Tattva Bodha, Atma Bodha, Viveka Chudamani, Upadesha Sahasri, Vakya Vritti, so many of them. So that a seeker, a student, will have the tools to supplement one's understanding when one listens to one's guru. Now let us spend some time on who qualifies, who is a qualified person or an adhikari, the eligible, to pursue the path of jnanam, jnana marga. Shankaracharya defines in Tattva Bodha that an adhikari is one who has the fourfold qualifications. Nitya nitya vastu vivekaha, iha mutrartha phala bhoga viragaha, shamadi shatka sampattihi, mumukshutvam cha iti. Nitya nitya vastu vivekaha, the ability to distinguish the eternal and ephemeral, nityam and anityam. Iha mutrartha phala bhoga viragaha, detachment from karma phalam in this life, iha and amutra, beyond this life. Shamadi shatka sampattihi, a group of six subsidiary qualifications, shama, dama, I will enumerate them, and all that. And mumukshutvam, the tivra iccha, the craving desire to get liberation. So the group of six sub-qualifications themselves, they are called the Shatka Sampatti. Shama means mind control. Dhamma means sense control. Uparama is compliance to one's swadharma and duties. Titiksha is acceptance of all pairs of opposites, sukham, dukkham, pleasure, pain, hot, cold, those kinds of things, titiksha. Shraddha, faith in the words of the guru and scriptures. Guru Vedanta Vakyadishu Vishwasaha Shraddha, to have the unconditional faith in the words of the Guru and scriptures. Because Guru doesn't speak anything of himself, he speaks only what is already given in the scriptures, what he has learned from the scriptures from his Guru. And Samadhanam means concentration or focus of mind, Chitta Ekagrata. So the one who has got all these qualifications, he is called a Sadhana Chaturtaya Sampannaha. And he is an adhikari. Karma yoga enables a person to gain this qualification. Now we have introduced another word, karma yoga. So we should understand what karma yoga is. What is karma yoga? It is only an attitudinal difference of performing any karma, any action. Doing an action with an attitude of either as one's duty or as an offering to the Lord. Ishvara Arpana Buddhi. Whatever I do, I offer to the Lord. It is not just whatever I do, guided by dharma. All that I offer to the Lord, or I do it as a sense of duty, without recourse to the phalam. As the Lord said in the Bhagavad Gita, karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phalahe turbhuhu ma te sangostva karmani. Karmani evadhikarahate. One has the right to perform one's duty only, ma phaleshu, not for the fruits of the action, karma phalam. Therefore, the same action performed with nishkama attitude without recourse to the phalam, as accepting the phalam as Ishvara Prasada, that is called Karma Yogi. So doing the karma as Ishvara Arpanam and accepting any result of the karma as Ishvara Prasada without anything directly to oneself, it's a Karma Yogi. And why this is important? Because again Acharya says in Viveka Chudamani, Chittasya Shuddhaye Karma. It is to give Chitta Shuddhi, internal purity. Unless the mind is pure, Aham Brahmasmi will never enter that mind. Na vastu palabhyate, not to directly gain the vastu, jnanam or moksha, but first to get the qualification to have Chitta Shuddhi, internal purity, so that when he goes to jnanam or marga, when he listens to Aham Brahmasmi, he will be able to relate to it. So all bhakti, upasana, they all come under karma only. Upasana gives chitta ekagrata, the one pointed focus on the only ultimate goal of moksha. So once a person gains these qualifications, then one can pursue jnana marga to gain self-knowledge and moksha. Therefore, what is the journey now? From a karmi, just an selfish action, action-oriented person. Selfish action-oriented person is a karmi. To karma yogi first. And then from karma yoga to jnana yoga. And through jnana yoga to gain jnanam. And to gain jnanam to gain moksha. This is the only route. And even this order cannot be changed. I cannot say I'll get jnana yoga first and then do karma yoga later. No. Karmi to karma yoga to jnanam to moksha is the only route as expounded in Vedantas and by our rishis. Now let us see what is jnana yoga. We spent some time on karma yoga. Let us see what is jnana yoga. Jnana yoga comprises essentially three steps. One is called shravanam. Another is manana, another is nididhyasana. Shravanam enables to gain the knowledge. The teacher tells, Aham Brahman Asmi, you are Brahman, I am Brahman. That knowledge, Tatvam Asi, that knowledge I gain. Aham Brahman Asmi, from the teacher I gain that knowledge. Mananam enables to remove all doubts, the doshas in the knowledge. First I get one doubt, how can I be Brahman? I am Alpajnaha, Alpashaktiman. I don't know anything. I am this miserable creature. How can I be the Lord? That is big doubt. And there could be two doshas also in that learning. The doshas can be twofold. One is from the teacher, the one who teaches that knowledge. And the second one is oneself, who is the student, who understands that knowledge. And among these two, the first dosha is not possible. Because when one seeks the teaching from a competent guru, who himself has a requirement, he should be a Shrotriya first, who has learned his knowledge from another guru, another competent guru, and who is Brahmanishtam, Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam. He should be not only a Shrotriya who has learned from another guru, who should be Brahmanishtam also, he should be firmly established in that knowledge. Through his sadhana, through jnana yoga, jnana marga. So the other source of doubts, that is the wrong understanding, is from oneself only. So the first source of doubt is removed. Second dosha is from oneself only. Therefore, again, refine the qualifications and start again. Go on doing this. Adhikarityam has to be again and again reiterated. Then the third step is nididhyasanam. This is the process to internalize this knowledge and to overcome any habitual tendencies. This is called viparita bhavana. Swamiji tells one example. Two Swamijis who are great learned people, who are maybe even Muktas even, and they were all invited to some gathering where they arrange some buffet dinner. Buffet dinners are all, you know, very common. So they go for a buffet dinner, and there are all kinds of foods are spread on the table. There are chapati, there are, you know, yogurt, rice, sambar, rasam, everything is there. And there is one Punjabi Swamiji and another one Tamil Nadu Swamiji or Kerala Swamiji or some South Indian Swamiji. And the Punjabi Swamiji, automatically he goes to the chapati side and dal side. Whereas the other Swamiji, he goes to idli and sambar and whatever it is. Both are Jivan Muktas, maybe even jnanis. But still the habitual tendency of the habit of food, habit of practices, this is called Viparita Bhava. Because they all could not be impediments in the path of jnana. Now let us see what is the premise of Advaita Vedanta. Vedanta, generally we call it Advaita Vedanta. Because all the other things, Dvaitam is also Vedanta only. Visishta Advaitam also is Vedanta only. Advaita Vedanta is also Vedanta. So when it comes to only one point, we differ. In Viveka Chudamani, Acharya Shankara gives in a nutshell, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya Jivo Brahmaivana Paraha. Brahman, the absolute alone is real. Brahma Satyam. This world, Jagat, Mithya, is unreal. We use the word Maya here. I will explain that. And the Jiva, Jivo Brahmaiva Naparaha, the Jiva or the individual is not different from Brahman. Naparaha. Now we have to understand the Upanishadic terms here. Brahman, Satyam, Mithya, Jiva, Jagat. All that we should understand. So to understand them, let us take first Satyam. So when we talk about Satyam, Sat. Sat means which is permanently existent. Satyam is not truth here, which is permanently existent. Permanently means what? Trikale api vidyamanam. That is Sat in all three domains of time, prime, past, present, and future. It should exist. And its opposite is Asatyam. Satyam and Asatyam are Asat. That is permanently non-existent. Sat is permanently existent. Asat is permanently non-existent. It is called the Trikale Avidyamanam Asat. That which does not exist after reality in all three domains of time. And then Mithya, which is temporarily existent. It is not Asat because it is not permanently non-existent. It is not Sat because it is not permanently existent. So being temporarily existent, it is Sat Asat Vilakshanam. Different from those two, and that is called Mithya. Now we will go to the next point here. When you take a temporarily existent thing, for example, say a pot, they normally give the examples of pot and clay and all that thing in Vedanta. So when you take a temporarily existent thing like a pot, this pot is born out of clay. It resolves black into clay. Not only that, the pot exists also because of clay alone. Without clay, there is no pot. Therefore, we can say that the temporary pot has got a dependent existence, or in other words, it does not have its own independent existence. From this, we can make a generalization. All temporary things enjoy dependent existence. They all exist because of depending on something else. Therefore, they don't have their own independent existence. From this, we see all mithya vastus are temporary things enjoy only dependent existence. All temporary things have got dependent existence. That is, they depend upon another thing for its existence. Suppose the other thing is also temporarily existent. Then that temporary thing will depend upon another, and therefore ultimately all temporary things should depend upon one thing, and that thing permanently and independently existent vastu, we call that sat or satya. Therefore the final point is what? All mithya vastus depend upon satyam or sat. So these three, what are these three? Sat, asat and mithya. So mithya depends upon another for its existence. Mithya depends ultimately upon satyam alone. So that is the concept we have to first understand. Now another important information is the Shruti, the Vedas, it accepts the existence of the world, Jagat, and talks about its origination also, Srishti and all that. The existence of various varieties in the world, existence of the means, the ends, the existence of laws governing the means and the ends. So all these accepted things by the Vedas, this is called in the logic, in the Nyaya terminology, it is called Adhyaropa. Adhyaropa means accepting all those things which are not really real. Now the mischievous Shruti, what it does, it later negates the very existence of the world itself. Thus, it goes on negating everything, neti, neti, nayeti, 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 goes on doing it, the whole world it negates and its existence, and this procedure is called apavada. So adhyaropa, acceptance of all the things in Jagat, and later negating all of them is called apavada using logic. Therefore, adhyaropa is the accept, I'm not explaining any of those things, they are all separate Vedanta lectures. I'm only orienting you to the thinking. So adhyaropa is the acceptance of the world and apavada is the negation. Since Shruti accepts the existence of the world cannot be called asat because Shruti accepts it. So in the later portion of the Vedas, the teaching, Shruti negates the whole creation and therefore it cannot be categorized as sat also because first it's accepted it is not asat. Because it negates later, it is not sat. So by definition, sat is that which is permanently existent in all three domains of time and that which cannot be dismissed or destroyed or cannot be negated. That is sat. Therefore, by negating the creation, Shruti wants to show, when I use the word Shruti, it is Vedas. Shruti wants to show that it does not accept the world as sat. So in the light of this teaching, the world will have to be accommodated only in the category of mithya. It is not asat, it is not sat, but it is mithya. That which that seems to be real, though not real. Seems to be real, apparently real, but not really real. Now we said mithya vastu can never exist independently because it enjoys dependent existence only. Therefore, mithya vastu should have a substratum or adhishtanam to support it. And that adhishtanam, Vedanta calls it as satya. Now, the Shruti has negated the whole world as mithya. And while establishing the satyam as its adhishtanam or substratum. Now, the question is what? What is that satyam? We cannot take anything in the world as satyam. Why? The whole world has been bundled as mithya by the scriptures. Therefore, whatever does not fall within the world, whatever is outside the possibility of the world, that remaining vastu alone must be satyam. And when everything is negated, what remains? Who remains? When everything in the Jagat is negated, what remains? Who remains? When everything is negated, I, the observer of everything alone remain in an unnegated form. We call it in Chaitanya Rupena or Sakshi Rupena. I alone remain. I, the capital I, not the body. I'll come to that. Therefore, when whole world is negated, Satyam becomes evident as myself. Vedanta sees the whole world as mithya. At the same time, I, the reminder, is viewed as satyam. That is the satyam. And then ultimately, we arrive at two things now. One is mithya prapancha, the mithya world jagat, and the other, the satyam I, through this adhyaropa and apavada method. We said a mithya vastu does not have its own independent existence, and therefore it is as good as non-existent. It is like one fellow, for example, is rich with borrowed money. A lot of people, they are rich with borrowed money. In America, it's very common to us. Originally, he is poor. Although he appears to be rich with borrowed money, he is credit worthy. He has a lot of money he borrowed. One dependent on another is as good as non-existence in our analysis. Therefore, mithya prapancha is as good as non-existent because such prapancha does not exist separate from satyam. Just as the pot is as good as non-existent because the pot cannot exist separate from the clay. Therefore, what is left out is clay, the satyam that is at the substratum level. I alone am left out. And mithya prapancha is as good as not there. The jagat is as good as not there. Therefore, I get a new name, Nishprapancham Atma Tattvam. That is, I am without this jagat prapancha. Nishprapancham Atma Tattvam I am. And what is the benefit I derive by getting this knowledge? The benefit is, once I know that the entire prapancha is mithya, and I'm also aware that I am the Satya Vastu, the knowledge makes me realize that mithya cannot affect me at all. Affect me, the Satyam, the I, the Atma. No pot can ever destroy the clay. No ornament can ever destroy the gold. No waves can ever destroy the ocean. Therefore, ornaments cannot threaten gold. Ornaments are but slaves to gold. Ornaments must own up that they survive because of the existence of gold. Without gold, there's no ornament. Every Upanishad, the Bhagavad Gita, they all talk about this one Satya Vastu, namely Brahma. It has different names, but only one entity. The Upanishads very clearly says, this Satya Vastu, actually Mundaka Upanishad nicely says, Ekam Eva Advitiyam, Ekam, one, Eva, only, Advitiyam, without two. That is Advaita. In Mandukya Upanishad, Nanta Pragyam, Na Bahish Pragyam, No Bhagata Pragyam, Na Pragyanaganam, Na Pragyam, Na Pragyam, Eka Atma Pratyasaram, Prapanchopashamam, Shantam, Shivam, Advaitam. Chaturtam manyante sa atmasa vigneha. Advaitam is not the concept of propounded by Adi Shankaracharya. A lot of people have that misunderstanding. It is not propounded by Adi Shankara. It's not Adi Shankara's upagnyam. It is Upanishadic. Kaivalya Upanishad very clearly says that jnana deva kaivalyam. Moksha is possible only through atmajnanam alone. So the evolution should be from one of dehoham, I am the body attitude, dehaham, I am the body attitude, identification of the body. Why? Because since birth, I have the body. That is the one closest to me. I know it right from birth. The body itself is viewed actually in two ways. Either as sharira trayam, namely sthura shariram, the grass body that everybody can see. Sukshma shariram, the subtle body. It consists of either 17 or 19 parts. 5 sense organs, 5 organs of action, 5 pranas, prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana, physiological functions, manas, buddhi, chitta, ahankara, all of them. And then the third one is called the karana sharira, the causal body, the cause of both sthula shariram and sukshma sharira, sharira dvayasya karana matram. This is one classification as sharira trayam or kosha panchakam. Of different sheets, 5 different koshas, layers. Annamaya kosha, the gross body. This can be called sthula shariram of the other classification. And then pranamaya kosha, manomaya kosha, vijnanamaya kosha, they are subtle body or sukshma shariram of the other classification. And anandamaya kosha, the karana shariram of the other classification. There are layers. All bodies are made up of panchabhutas only, five elements, which are inert matter. Body is inert matter. I think I am the body. So from that body, when somebody asks you, who are you? We start giving our name. We start telling about, I am so much tall, so much weight. I am manager, I am this, I am father, son. All refer to the body. So from that body identification, dehoham, dehahaham, one should go to jivoham, jivahaham. I am the jivatma identification should come. That means atma association comes. And then from jivoham, one should warn up brahmatvam, brahmoham. I am the all-pervading Brahman. As sat, the satyam, the ultimate reality. As chit, the chaitanyam, the awareness. And ananda or ananta, the infinite. And this Brahman, as the absolute entity, actually in Mundaka Upanishad, very nicely it says, yatta dadreshyam, agrahyam, agotram, avarnam, achakshu, srotram, tad apani padam, nityam, vibhum, sarvagatam, susukshmam, tad avyayam, yad bhutayoni paripashyante dhiraha, jnaninaha, they see like this, which is cannot be, which is not visible, dreshyam, agrahyam, which cannot be grasped. There is no root, no features, no eyes, no ears, hand, legs, none of them, no name, nama, rupa, karma. Doesn't have any of them. It is the nirguna chaitanya. For us, creation is a cyclic process. We don't have linear thinking. For us, creation is a cyclic process. From manifest form to dormant form to manifest form. Goes on and on and on forever. It is only transformation and not really creation in that sense. Nothing is newly created. Nothing is completely destroyed or anything. Manifest to dormant, dormant to manifest. Cycle continues forever. So even though in the empirical plane, we have all these pluralities, in the absolute plane, negating everything as mithya. The satya vastu I, not the body, but the nirguna chaitanyam alone exists. With the existence in the absolute sense of the term, trikale api tishtati, as was said earlier. Therefore, the journey is what? Towards warning up the nirguna jnanam. That is from karmi, who is engaged in karma expecting results, to karma yoga, who is engaged in the same karma without recourse to the results, but as an offering to the Lord or with sense of duty, and become an adhikari, sadhana chaturtaya sampannaha, and then pursue jnana yoga, shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam, and gain jnanam from jnana yoga, shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam. Then the jnani is akarta. Once he becomes a jnani, he becomes akarta, abhokta, karma phalam does not affect that jnani. He is not doer, he is not enjoyer. The jnani will exhaust the prarabdha in this jarma, of course, that has to be. All the karmas, prarabdha, agami, and all that, sanjita karmas, they are all, of course, different topics. I just only mentioned the names here. Jnani will exhaust the prarabdha, which was responsible for him to take this janma. And agami karmas, the future karmas that one is doing in this birth itself, since till jnanam is a thing. And that they also don't affect him after gaining jnanam. And sanchita karma, the accumulated karma of innumerable births and janmas earlier, that is also burnt at the time of jnana, because the jnani does not have a need to have another birth to exhaust even the sanskrita karmas. Because the karma dahatva samarthyam, the burning ability of karmas is there for jnanam alone. So jnanam can destroy all the karma. Now we have to have one more clarification here. Namely, if the Advaitins say that there is only one vastu and all others are not real, does it mean the world is not real? All jivas are not real? Are you not real? I am not real? Vedas are not real? Here only Advaitins bring the concept of vyavaharika satyam, practical reality, and paramarthika satyam, absolute reality. So from the angle of vyavaharika satyam, world is real. People are real. Dvaitam is real, but that is of a lower order of reality, since we cannot attribute reality in all three domains of time. It is subject to vikaram, savikaram, modifications. From the time, for example, we started this lecture today, And by the time we reached the end, what happened? We already aged by 45 minutes or 1 hour. How many cells multiplied? Whereas from Paramarthika Drishti, absolute reality, Brahman alone enjoys absolute reality. It is the causeless cause of the entire creation in association with Maya. Similarly, we also have Saguna Ishvara with names, forms, attributes, Ganesha, Shiva, Vishnu, all Saguna Ishvaras, all attributes in the Vyavaharika plane. All pujas, upasanas are all directed towards that only. Devatas are also exalted jivas only. But they have attained those status by lot of punya karmas. And they have got also a lot of mystic powers also. Then someone might ask, why you then worry about this absolute reality at all? Relative reality, life is good. Everything is nice for me. Why should I worry about this Paramarthika Satyam at all? Why not continue as is? No problem. Enjoy endless cycles of birth and death. No guarantee that the next birth is going to be even a human janma. That is what the Vedanta says. Of course, this is for those who believe in our scriptures, rebirth and all that. For those who don't have faith in our scriptures, we have nothing to say to them. So before I conclude, I will now recite a text called Brahma Jnanavali of Adi Shankaracharya. It's a very beautiful hymn. I like it so much. So I wanted to now recite it for you, which is considered as the Prakarana Grantha written by Adi Shankaracharya. Sakrut Shravana Matrena Brahma Jnanam Yato Bhavet Brahma Jnanavali Mala Sarvesha Moksha Siddhaye. They give the palam of this so that I will give the interest for you to listen. Just by hearing this once, knowledge of Brahman is attained and enables all to attain liberation and moksha. That is the Palashruti of this particular Grantha. So let us just only recite this alone. Asangoham, asangoham, asangoham punapunaha, sachidananda rupoham, ahamevahamuvyayaha, nityashuddha vimuktoham, nirakarohamavyayah bhumananda swarupoham ahamevahamavyayah nityoham niravadyoham nirakarohamachyutah paramananda rupoham ahamevahamavyayah Shuddha Chaitanya Rupoham Atma Ramoham Evacham Akhandananda Rupoham Ahamevaham Avyayaham Pratyak Chaitanya Rupoham Shantoham Prakrite Paraham Shashwatananda Rupoham Ahamevahamavyayah Tattvatita Paratmaham Madhyatita Parashivah Mayatita Paranjyotihi Ahamevahamavyayah Nanarupavyatitoham Chidakarohamachyutah Sukharupaswarupoham ahamevahamavyayah Mayatatkarya dehadim mamanastyeva sarvadam Swaprakashokarupoham ahamevahamavyayah Gunatrayavyatitoham brahmadinancha sakshyaham Ananta-ananta rupoham ahamevahamavyayaham Antaryami swarupoham kutasthasarvagospyaham Paramatma swarupoham ahamevahamavyayaham Nishkaloham nishkriyoham sarvatmadya sanatanaha aparokshaswarupoham अहमेवाहमव्ययः द्वन्द्वादिसाक्षि रूपोऽहम् अचलोऽहम् सनातनः सर्वसाक्षिस्वरूपोऽहम् अहमेवाहमव्ययः प्रज्ञानघन एवाहम् विज्ञानघन एव च अकर्ताहम् अभोक्ताहम् अहमेवाहमव्ययः निराधारस्वरूपोऽहम् सर्वाधारोऽहमेव च आप्तकामस्वरूपोऽहम् अहमेवाहमव्ययः तापत्रयविनिर्मुक्तः देहत्रयविलक्षणः अवस्थात्रयसाक्ष्यस्मि च अहमेवाहमव्ययः दृग्दृश्यौ द्वौ पदार्थौ स्तः परस्परविलक्षणौ दृग्ब्रह्मदृश्यं मायेति सर्ववेदान्तडिण्डिमः अहं साक्षीति यो विद्यात् विचित्रैवं पुनः पुनः स एव मुक्तः सो विद्वान् इति वेदान्तडिण्डिमः घटकुड्यादिकं सर्वं मृत्तिकामात्रमेव च तद्वद्ब्रह्म जगत्सर्वम् इति वेदान्तडिण्डिमः ब्रह्मसत्यं जगन्मित्यां जीवो ब्रह्मैव नापरः अनेन वेद्यं यच्चास्त्रम् इति वेदान्तडिण्डिमः अन्तर्ज्योतिर्बहिर्ज्योतिः प्रत्यग्ज्योतिपरात्परः ज्योतिर्ज्योतिस्वयं ज्योतिः आत्मज्योतिःशिवोम्यहम् ज्योतिर्ज्योतिस्वयं ज्योतिः आत्मज्योतिःशिवोम्यहम् All my lectures on the Upanishads, Brahma Sutras and Bhagavad Gita, Prakarana Granthas like Viveka Chudamani, Tattva Bodham, Sarva Vedanta Sangraha, Dakshinamurti Stotram, Nirvana Shaktam, all those, Upadesha Panchakam, they are all, and Vaidya Samskaras, Vishnu Sahasranamam, Lalita Sahasranamam, Shivananda Lahari, Saundarya Lahari. They are all in my website, yagyam.org, if anyone is interested. यो वेदादौ स्वरप्रोक्तो वेदान्ते च प्रतिष्ठितः तस्य प्रकृतिलीनस्य यः परः महेश्वरः श्रीमत्परमहंसेत्यादि समस्तबिरुदावली विराजमानः श्रीमज्जगद्गुरु श्री श्री भारतीतीर्थमहास्वामिनां तत्करकमलसञ्जातं श्रीमज्जगद्गुरु श्री श्री विदुशेखर भारती महास्वामिनां च शरणारविन्दयोः साष्टाङ्गप्रणामान् समर्पयामः ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु नारायण बैक टू यू डॉक्टर
जंबुनाथन गो अहेड प्लीज Please unmute yourself.
Namaskaram. Yeah. Sorry, Mama. I got delayed because there was some delay in unmuting. Namaskaram. Shashtanga Pramanam to Mama and all our Jagatgurus. Wonderful exposition of Vedanta. And, you know, Mama started like as for us from a child, beginning with what are the goals of life. What are the ways of achieving the goals of life, going through Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, and covering Mundaka Upanishad, Mandukya Upanishad, Viveka Chudamani, Bhagavad Gita, Kaivalya Upanishad, and whatnot. It was a wonderful exposition for all our, you know, from the beginning. And I think it was a very stupendous lecture to start our Vande Vidyashankaram, and we are very grateful to Mama. And Mama chanted Brahma Jnana Veli, but we are going to chant a much simpler one, which is will get us the, you know, the blessings of Mama as well as all our gurus. If just we can wait for 2 minutes, I will finish this really quickly, very appropriate stotra for this day and time. It is called Guru Ashtakam, composed by Jagadguru Adishankara himself. It was supposed to be composed on his guru Govindapada, but it applies to all of us too. And it is a prayer to the guru. And like Mama says in the, specifically the Guru Anugraha is very important for the Mahavakyas to get impregnated in our mind and released, because the Palashruti of the Guru Ashtakam says, Guru Ashtakam Yapatet Punya Dehi Yatir Bhupatir Brahmachari Chagehi Labved Vanchitartam Padam Brahmasagyam Guru Rukta Vakye Mano Yeshya Lagdam. So to get the Guru Vakya impregnated in your mind, this Guru Ashtakam has to be recited every day. That's what Adishankara himself says. So the Guru Vakyams are more important, but for Guru Vakyam to get impregnated, we need Guru Kadaksha too. Shariram Shurupam Tata Bhakalatram Yashascharu Chitram Dhanam Me Rutulyam Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Kalatram Dhanam Putra Pautra Disarvam Griham Bandavasarva Meta Dijatam Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Shadangadi Vedo Muke Shastra Vidya Kavitva Digadyam Supadyam Karoti Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Videsheshu Manya Swadeshu Danya Sadachar Vritteshu Matyo Nacharya Matto Nachanya Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Shama Mamandale Bhupa Bhupala Brindai Sadase Vitam Yasya Pada Ravindam Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Yashome Gatam Dikshu Dana Prathapa Jagat Vastu Sarvam Kare Yat Prasadat Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Na Boge Na Yogi Navabaji Rajo Nakanta Mukina Vavitte Shuchitam Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Aranye Navasvasya Gehe Nakari Nadehe Mono Vartate Me Twanarge Guru Rangri Padme Manaschena Lagnam Tatakim 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 Guru Rashtakam Yapatet Punya Dehi Yatir Bhupatir Brahmachari Chagehi Labed Vanchitartam Padam Brahmasagyam Guru Ruktavake Mano Yashya Lagnam Harigi Hom Shri Guru Bhyo Namah. Thank you very much, Mama, for this wonderful lecture and for blessing us with all the Vedanta knowledge. Hopefully with your guidance, we can proceed very successfully in this spiritual progress.
Thank you so much. Very nice.
All of you, if you please visit this website here if you want more information. Next week, we'll have a lecture from 4 to 5 from Dr. Jambunathan. After that, we will have lectures from various other scholars. So please do visit and continue to enjoy the fruits of this. Thank you so much. Hari Om. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnahat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.